Great sprawling New Yorker stuff. That's what screenwriter Charlie Kaufman was trying to capture out of Susan Orlean's The Orchid Thief. But what does that even mean? Well, in the case of today's book, it would seem to mean a writer who writes deeply and incisively about other people and their professions in an effort to understand herself while consciously avoiding actually talking about herself. But now it would appear she's trapped herself in a collection of essays. Or has she freed herself? We'll talk about it today on Book of the Day. Welcome back to Book of the Day on CPL Radio. This is a show where we talk about a book every day. That's the goal, anyway. I am Jeff Messerman in Wisconsin, and that is Steve Donahue in Boston, our book critic at large. We're so lucky to have him. Good day, Steve.
Hello, everybody.
And today we're talking about this is a historic day. We're talking about our first collection of essays on this show. What do we have here, Steve?
Collection. This is A Left-Handed Woman by Judith Thurman. This is a collection of pieces from The New Yorker over many, many years. She's been writing for them and writing what your teaser very appropriately calls quintessential New Yorker stuff. The New Yorker comes in for a great deal of ribbing, and I love watching it set themselves up for it. But one of the things they do and have done for almost exactly 100 years is take a really smart author and just give them their head, you know, go ahead, write what you want, and then we'll see. We'll heavily fact check it, we'll heavily edit it, but we won't hamper you. And this is a volume that shows the riches you get if you do that. The New Yorker is eye-wateringly expensive to subscribe to, but I would say still very much worth it for exactly this kind of writer.
Absolutely.
And Judith Thurman, I think, would probably smile a bit at your description of a writer who talks about delving into the lives and minds of others while trying hard, by being obviously leery to divulge much of herself. Mm-hmm. I love it when I think I'm wrong. I'm not wrong in thinking that she's probably an introvert, and brainy introverts always end up writing pieces like this where they are straining hard both to examine themselves and not to show their work.
Absolutely.
A classic example from 100 years ago would be A Backward Glance by Edith Wharton, which is the exact same way. But when she turns her focus to other things, which is all, you know, the nominal subjects of all of these pieces, she's spectacularly good. In a very slow, steeped way. When I was reading this again for our little chat today, I was thinking how very non-21st century this stuff is. Ordinarily, in the 21st century, when I get a book that titles itself Essays, I wince, because that's not what it's going to be. It's going to be, I don't know, Twitter threads frozen in amber, or stand-up comedy routines with, you know, the pause lines left out or whatnot. It's not going to be, when you think of essay, you think of something that is winding and probing and not necessarily pro forma. In a really good essay, you won't know where it's going, and you'll get the strong sense that the author isn't completely going either.
That's true.
That's very valuable. And she does it. She does it really, really well. These pieces sparkle. I've read The New Yorker for a long, long, long time. Calvin Coolidge and I used to run to the dime store to get our copies. But, so I've read, I think, probably everything in here. After a while, when you're reading a magazine like The New Yorker, you mentally note the authors you definitely don't want to miss. And early on, I think I probably noted that about Judith Thurman. So I've probably read everything in here, but it all feels new when it's in an anthology. Anthologies like this are tough to sell to publishers.
Oh, certainly, certainly. The introduction, if the introduction is any indication to the voice in the rest of the book, she's very readable, very conversational.
And a bit easy. She confesses in the introduction that she's left-handed. How many people have the stones to do that?
I work with one of those. Her name is Sarah. She'll be thrilled that I brought her up today. I give her ribbing about it, which is just not, of course. Now I feel terrible having read that introduction. So I'm one of these people.
she frets in her introduction that the back and forth between her and her editor was that all her original ideas for how to package this collection seemed doom and gloomy, would probably put off the reader. And that doesn't happen for me anyway. I thought this was shot through with the bright, just bright light of a big inquisitive brain just looking at everything around it. What's the subject of my attention today?
Yeah.
And the book is broken up into different subject headings. And only one of those headings is literature. But the for those of the readers who are interested in this sort of thing, the book is absolutely saturated with bookishness.
Yeah.
It isn't just confined to that one area. It's everywhere. It's absolutely everywhere in the book.
Absolutely.
It's delightful to see.
She lasers in on minutia, again, in the small bits I've read. And she does it in such a way that is not awkward. It's refreshing and entertaining. I found her introduction, like I said, wildly readable.
She also has a really good aptitude for tossed off little bits of wisdom. That are really stick with you. I want to read a couple of those.
Please.
One is about Emily Dickinson. And now it's a whole article, it's a whole piece about Emily Dickinson, but there's one line that just leaped out at me. I'm sure that I will, now that I've reread it, I'm sure that I will remember it and use it in my mind for the rest of my life. She writes, "It is hard to believe that Dickinson didn't know who and what she was, even if no one else did." That's fantastic. That's just fantastic. And there's another one I want to read you. Another quick one here. Some people inflict pain upon themselves in order to replay and to master cruel treatment that they once endured helplessly.
Ooh.
That's marvelous. That's absolutely marvelous.
That's a bit incisive.
And little bits of that are all through here. But I want to indulge in one more reading that's a little longer, because sometimes, in fact, often in this book, she descends to my level. Often in this book, she goes straight down to the brass tacks of actually reviewing something. And when she does that, she does it fantastically good. There's a piece in here where she reviews Stacy Schiff's biography of Cleopatra, which you certainly have in the library, right? Mm-hmm. You certainly do. It is such a fantastic book. And she reviews it here in context of a couple of other people who have written about Cleopatra, which is pretty much everybody. Your 1971 book on Cleopatra was wonderful. I wrote about it a lot in my 1972 book on Cleopatra.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Here she writes, "Whether we like it or not, biographers bring their experience as men or women to their task. Roller and Goldsworthy, that's two previous biographers, both seem determined to resist the temptations of a siren, as if she might corrupt their integrity. Schiff relies on the same venerable cleophobes and exercises the same caution about them. She takes her epigraph from Euripides, 'Man's most valuable trait is a judicious sense of what not to believe.' Imaginative attunement with the subject, however, does not have a compromise, does not have to compromise a vigilant biographer's critical detachment. And Schiff's beautiful writing hums with that tension. It is an edifice of speculation and conjecture, like every Cleopatra ever written, but unlike nearly all of them, it is a work of literature."
Very nice.
But in this case, I don't need to agree to find that really good. And I think you can see from that longer bit of prose what I'm talking about, which is that her thinking is dense. It winds, it weaves up and down in the registers. Just marvelous to watch it happen. And it never fails. There aren't any bad pieces.
Sentence structure, pyrotechnics in some ways. And she even mentions that in her intro, that she appreciates so much the mastery of sentence. Like, and mentions Joan Didion more than once in her intro as well. And then it just comes out in her writing, which is great. I mean, she mentions she appreciates it and that she's passionate about that, and then she achieves it. So, I mean, what right. a great...
Yeah. Which is a refreshing change from some writers who in their introductions will say, "Well, I love the language. I'm so passionate about the beauty of the sentence on the sentence level."
Yeah.
And then you read the book. And it's 100% coffee and Xanax. Right. And so you're thinking, okay, well, either you didn't pay attention to yourself or somebody else wrote your introduction, but not in this case.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why I brought up originally that a collection like this of pieces, these are some pieces that ran in the New Yorker, is a tough sell to agents and publishers. It's an uphill climb no matter who you are.
Tough sell to my patrons too, really.
Well, it's a tough sell to them as well, and that's really what we're doing here.
Yeah,
the publisher took a flyer on this thing and it was worth it, and if if this isn't usually your cup of tea, you might want to give it a try.
Certainly, certainly. I knew nothing about this collection until this morning when I opened my email and check the roster, and I do just a cursory glance at the book, and I thought, well, Amazon has the introduction available, and I read it, and I immediately wanted the rest. So it's a good sign.
Maybe something to think about.
Absolutely.
Into the system. Or is it in your broader system? Is it
doesn't seem to be yet. I will rectify
that's
that.
That's not a fault of the Monarch system. Mm-hmm. That's just the attitude towards books like this.
Yeah.
Anthology of reprinted columns or reviews. It's an uphill climb for everybody involved. Publishers don't know how to flog them. Publishers don't know what to buy, whether to buy them or how to pay for them. And readers tend to be leery of them. And that ought not to be. In this case, that ought not to be.
She said something very amusing in her intro as well that stuck with me, how men are not terribly prevalent, she said, in the pages of that, her collection of essays. But she said they're quite prevalent in the intro, and that she mentioned something along the lines of like a certain handsiness of men that she's dealt with her entire career. And then she leaves it at that, which I thought was just refreshing and great. It's not the main, I thought that was a really nice touch and an interesting flair. And so it's not going to dwell on any kind of, trauma. It's just something that she's been around long enough that was just the way. And she understands that and recognizes it. Let it go. So I was very intrigued. I'm very excited to add that one to our collection. So,
well, anything I can do to broaden the horizons of my producer.
You have accidentally done it. I resist every single day. I fight him tooth and nail. Now my horizons have really knocked out the windows and kicked out a wall. What can you do? All right. That's what we do here at Book of the Day every day, Monday through Friday. Thank you as always, Steve.
That was my pleasure.
Much appreciated.